Hello this fine day and welcome to Prophecy in the News. This is an update. I'm your host, Dr. Kevin Clarkson. And as we are in this wonderful time of year, the end of the year, the anticipation of a new, I want to talk with you about anticipating our new life, our new existence through all eternity. I believe in the resurrection of the body. The Bible teaches it. It's mentioned at the end of the Apostles' Creed. And it's clear that we are going to have an eternal state of existence with the Lord. I began to think about that and began to look into that recently and did some Bible study, shared these remarks with members of our church, and I want to share some of the thoughts with you today because I think it's something that we don't often engage our minds with enough about the cataclysmic change that awaits those who are going to be taken home to be with the Lord. So let's look into the Scripture, 1 Corinthians 15, and I'll be reading verses 50 to 57, and here's what it says. Now this I say, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Now Paul is saying these things kind of in conclusion of a long chapter, 1 Corinthians 15, that is all about the resurrection of the dead. And he's bringing these things from the simple thought that Jesus really did rise to what that means for you and I as his believers and followers. And the fact that he rose promised that we would rise. You see, Jesus told his disciples, because I live, you also will live. And he told Mary and Martha as he was preparing to raise their brother Lazarus, who had been in the grave for 4 days, do you believe in the resurrection? And they say, well, we know that he'll rise at the last day. Jesus said unto them, I am the resurrection and the life. So the resurrection is not just some fuzzy doctrine. It really is contained and embodied in the person of our Lord Jesus Christ. He is the resurrection and the life. So when I say I'm looking forward to resurrection, that's another big dose of Jesus, if you will. And so the Scripture's teaching us some incredible things here, and I want to explore them with you in this update and another. Just some thoughts that come right out of this passage we just read. First of all, we will be changed. Make no mistake about that fact. The Scripture said three times in these 7 or 8 verses, we would be changed. It says in verse 51, we shall all be changed. And then it says in verse 52, we shall be changed. Now the word change there is an interesting word. It means to alter, to transform, to make different, to exchange, even to cause one thing to stop and another to take its place. As you think about our resurrection, the Bible is saying there's going to come such a fantastic change that you and your body, as you've lived and known it, is going to actually cease and stop, and something entirely different will take its place. Not as different as night and day, but you'll be recognizable, but the state of your being, the power of your new body, the endurance of your existence eternally, going to be so different, we shall be changed. Now, it says something very interesting here, and I think we need to capture this. The Scriptures talks about those who have fallen asleep, and this reminds us of the passage in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 that says when the Lord does return, we who are alive and remain are going to be caught up, but we will not precede or go before those who are asleep in the Lord. That speaks of the sleep of death, not of the soul. For to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Your spirit and consciousness are always going to be with Him. But the body is laid in the ground, and the body returns to dust and to ashes. And the Lord is going to resurrect that body of His believers on that great getting up morning when He returns and calls His people home. We often call that day the rapture, when the living are caught up and the dead are raised. But it actually is one huge aspect of the resurrection taken together. We will all be changed, living or dead. If we know Christ in that moment, we will be fantastically altered. And I love that. The passage said very clearly, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, verse 51. That touches on those saints who are alive and those who have already died. We will not all sleep. Paul knew there'd be a final generation. He knew that there would be those living when Christ returned, and they wouldn't sleep the sleep of death. But all followers of Christ will be changed. So that is a dramatic thing. I would say to you also that we have to be changed because of verse 50. This I say, brethren, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does corruption inherit incorruption. We literally have to be changed, dear folks, and here's why. This body that we have now could not stand in the presence of God. The Bible says God is holy. He dwells in a light unapproachable. God told Moses that no man may look at my face and live. It's because the body we now live in is a body of sin. Our flesh is contaminated with the sin nature. We have a bent or a default setting that we rebel against God. Salvation's not only being forgiven, it's having that default setting worked on. But until we stand on the other side, we will be tempted and we will still choose sin sometimes. We look forward to the day when that sin nature is gone, when that fallen aspect is totally removed. That's why this change is necessary, so that we can remain in a state of sinlessness, but it's also necessary so that we can stand and bask in the glory of God without being consumed and condemned. So we will be changed. Another truth in these verses is that we will be changed instantly. The scripture says it'll be in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound. Think about that. That word moment in Greek is literally the word atom. They say atomos, but it's the word atom. It's the smallest, most indivisible part of matter that the Greek mind was aware of. They didn't have the type of nuclear microscopes we do to see that an atom has a neutron and a proton and electrons. But they knew that the smallest part of matter to them was the atom. That's the word Paul uses. In an atom, smaller than you can make it. In the twinkling of an eye, not the blink of an eye. You know, we can blink and a camera can measure the shutter speed and how quickly we blink. But a twinkle is a flash of light in your eye. And I wouldn't begin to understand where God's third heaven really is geographically and spatially, but I know that it's out there. And that God is going to send His Son from the third heaven to gather His people. And faster than your eye can twinkle, faster than an atomic measurement of time, Jesus will transcend time and space and come for His people. And in that instant, we will be changed. What an exciting thing to think how instantaneous that is going to be. Matthew 24, 27, Jesus compared His coming to the flashing of lightning that goes across the sky. From the east to the west, even so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. And when Jesus returns, it's going to be that quick. And the lightning flash, even though you may capture it with shutter speeds on cameras, it is so quick it is here and gone. You see the light longer than you see the flash. And Jesus said it would be like that. Paul says in a flash we will be changed. So we can look forward to that. Not only will we be changed and changed instantly, we'll be changed radically. And that's where we'll be going in the next update, and I look forward to talking with you about that. Listen, if you don't know Christ, you can't look forward to this wonderful future. In fact, you'll be resurrected, but the Bible says it's only that you might stand before God and be condemned and cast into the lake of fire. Jesus doesn't want that for you. That's why He came and died in your place and rose again to give you everlasting life. So I hope you'll call on Him today and receive His forgiveness if you don't know Him. Those of us who do, we're going to keep looking up. God bless you, and thank you for watching today.